Just outside the war memorial here, we have this statue of Sir Edward Wherry Dunlop. And there's some information about Mr. Dunlop there, or Sir Dunlop in this case. And around here we see that it was founded by Meridian Sculpture Founders. This company is down in Melbourne. There is also another statue of Sir Edward Dunlop down in Melbourne. But you'll notice that the name Meridian refers to a measurement of the cosmos, if you will. So we currently find ourselves at the National Service Memorial here in Canberra. We're just outside the Australian War Memorial in the courtyard here. And the memorial itself here is positioned within the St. Andrew's Cross as seen from above. The sculpture here itself, the water feature, I noticed when I looked at a set of tarot cards, we have the square here representing earth perhaps, with the circle representing air and the triangle representing fire, with the water, the waters representing water. Perhaps fittingly, right in the center here, there is a little vortex in the water there. So a little vortex sort of going down into this sacred geometry, if you will, here. We also have representation of various elements as well, and these elements are perhaps caused by different frequencies. If you look down on this, as per this coin that I'm showing now, you'll see the eye as well, the eye looking up in this case. So we have two war memorials here. We have one in the background here that is perhaps the male counterpart to this female one here. If we have a look at it, it looks more sort of male-esque in stature and all the rest of it, quite erect, so to speak. We also have the three steps going up, which would perhaps be from the lodge floor up the three steps to the Master Mason's chair. And we'll just have a closer look at this this one here. So here we go. But first of all, we'll just have a look in between, and there is a kookaburra sitting up in the tree there. So this memorial here is dedicated to all women who served, suffered and died in all wars and in defence of Australia. And we have the female curve running through the middle here, and we have the element of water running through. Water is a female element. We now find ourselves outside the Bomber Command War Memorial here in Canberra, in the grounds of the Australian War Memorial. Now, this middle part here is perhaps the phallus, the male part here with the waters below. So the male part is coming out of the waters here below. So we have the male and female represented in this sculpture here. Here we have a sculpture simply titled War,
featuring Belladonna, the Roman goddess of war. And we can see above the head here, the skull. And the skull perhaps is Saturnian, because Kronos is sort of overlooks death, the process of death, with the scythe and all the rest of it, the Grim Reaper. And we have this figure here, this strange figure perhaps looking over the earth. And I suspect that this is a representative of entities that basically only the secret societies of the world are engaging with in ritual. So this is the plaque of the Sandakan Memorial. Now, this memorial commemorates the death marches in Borneo at the end of the Second World War. The memorial is a sundial, a horizontal sundial, and the gnomon would be here. I've just placed a little compass on there. And the gnomon casts a shadow. So it would cast a shadow to this line over here for the winter solstice, and this line here for the summer solstice. This line here, now this is a World War II memorial, but this is a World War I event, and that's what we know as Remembrance Day, which was the 11th of the 11th at 11 a.m. So the 11th of November, and that was in 1918, when the armistice was signed in a carriage in France. So the armistice, the ceasing of arms, and the 11 is a number that is dear to Freemasons. They originally had 11 pillars. So that's this memorial. So that's the Sandakan Memorial over there. And I'm currently standing now outside the Australian War Memorial itself, and I'll just do a 180 degrees towards the direction of Parliament over here, and we are looking down Anzac Parade here. Right in front of me is an altar. Now there are three steps going up to that altar. Once again, those three steps may refer to the three steps coming up off the Masonic floor. And then we have the altar here. Now, the altar is a place where male and female unite. They become one, perhaps, in a sense. There is an alteration to their being. And an altar is also a place where, perhaps, entities maybe interact with beings as well, during ritual and that sort of thing. And that is a guess on that respect. Now this, the redness here that you can see, or the orangey colour going down here, I've read it, it was just in a hotel article, that it was described as perhaps a river of blood, commemorating a river of blood. So it is perhaps a bloodline going down there, and that, you know, that article may in fact be true. There are these sections on here, these green sort of rectangle, I think they are rectangles, and there are 28 of them, and 28 is perhaps the number of the moon, so those rectangles there perhaps are a signify the moon and the cycle of the moon. So we'll proceed down Anzac Parade here a little.
Before we head down Anzac Parade, I'd just like to point out a couple of things. In Guy Freeland's book, Canberra Cosmos, we can read on page 92, the red gravel symbolises blood spilt on the field of battle. Another thing is that Anzac is an acronym for Australian and New Zealand Army Corps. So let's head down Anzac Parade.
Within the Australian Hellenic memorial here, we can see this, it's like a pizza wedge, if you will, coming out of the center of it, which is perhaps a familiar motif. You can see it in other places around Canberra, such as the museum in Canberra. The metallic part in the middle perhaps refers to the metal of the earth, the esoteric metal of the earth. So I'm now standing right in the middle of Anzac Parade here, and just across to the side here is the Korean War Memorial here on Anzac Parade. Now if we have a look at this war memorial, in the front here we see an obelisk. Now that obelisk is perhaps a penis, a phallus. To each side we have the two testicles, and on those testicles we have these streamers, if you like, which perhaps represent sperm. Now at the sides we have the pubic hairs, so to each side we have the pubic hairs, and amidst those pubic hairs rocks, which perhaps gives new meaning to getting your rocks off. Now at this side we have a man here, and he would be from the army, so all three of the forces are represented here. We have another man here in here, he would be the airman. And then the last man here with this very phallic object, he's holding this bomb here, he would be from the Navy. So he would be a seaman, and he is amidst the pubic hairs there. Now in behind, in between the testicles, if you will, over here, we have a ceiling up here, and in that ceiling is an opening, which is perhaps a vaginal opening, if you will, for the phallus here. But that is an obelisk, and usually around obelisks, phallic obelisks, we have the female counterpart, and we really do have that across the other side of the road here, where we have the Australian Service Nurses Memorial over here. So we'll just go and have a closer look at that, and I think you'll see what I'm talking about. So here I am outside the memorial here, and in the middle here we have these glass structures which perhaps represent the element of water, and they're curved also, and they perhaps represent the waters of the female. And to the sides here we have two steps, perhaps representing the labia minora and the labia majora. And again to this side we have this two-step configuration with the labia minora and the labia majora here. We have the grasses here around the outside. They are around other memorials here, but they do perhaps represent pubic hair. And we're just going to have a look across the other side here. Yeah, so across the other side here we have this Vesica Pisces shape once again, this vaginal shape once again, where we have the labia minora on the inside and the labia majora on the outside. And again over here the two-step configuration, labia minora, labia majora. In the middle here we have the bush, and you will see this on the Presbyterian Church logo also, and the bush perhaps refers to the fornix, and the bush gets burnt, and that's the burning, and that refers to enlightenment as per the work of Bill Donohue. Here is a picture of the Australian Service Nurses National Memorial here on Anzac Parade, and this is in the as part of an article in the Freemasons magazine for the New South Wales and the ACT. Mm-hmm.
These sculptures are a gift from New Zealand to Australia. There are Maori and Aboriginal aspects to the design. The arches officially represent the handles of a kite, the Maori term for flax basket. According to the official newspaper of the Royal Australian Air Force, New Zealand's High Commissioner in Canberra, Mr. S. Murdoch, described that the New Zealand Memorial would be one of those works of art that would warrant more than one viewing. The memorial would have great depth and subtlety owing to its design, which incorporated and acknowledged the vibrancy of the Aboriginal and Maori cultures. Well, Mr. Murdoch, I for one will take your advice, because when I take, quote, more than one viewing, unquote, I suspect that I see arches representing the path of the sun, Horus, going from Horus I zone to Horus I zone, as it traverses the Egyptian pyramids below. The sun, a deity, giving us light during the daylight hours. Perhaps daylight is deity light, and perhaps hours is Horus. Among the various symbols here, I see checkers that possibly represent, in part, base consciousness or duality thinking. Wavy lines possibly represent frequency and vibration. The ever-expanding concentric rings also may represent other realms or planes. The vibrational lines traverse these planes. On top of them sit triangles within the pyramids, perhaps representing in part unified, completed consciousness. Just before we depart from Anzac Parade, I'd just like to make mention of a few of the other war memorials. You're currently looking at the Royal Australian Navy Memorial. There is also the Royal Australian Air Force Memorial, with their motto per ardua ad astra, which in Latin means through adversity or through struggle to the stars. Within our human subconscious, we possibly want to travel to the stars, and many car companies name their vehicles after stars and planets. Here in Australia, we have a popular car company called Holden, the logo of which was designed by Freemason Rainer Hoff and features Leo the Lion with the sun. Now, another interesting thing about cars is that we drive them across the Earth and they're named after stars. Just as the stars move across the skies above, the cars move across the Earth below. We'll now look at the Vietnam Memorial, and within the Vietnam Memorial we have a triangle and then we have a circle above there, so the circle lies within the triangle, and it is my opinion that the design of this memorial reflects the triangle of conjuration within Solomonic magic. Moving on from that, we have the Kemal Ataturk Memorial. Now, this memorial features the pentagram, the five-pointed star with the moon, and once again, these part of the use of these symbolisms is that they can be used within magic ritual, particularly the pentagram. There is also another interesting memorial, and that is a memorial for World War One, with the what is soldiers and horses on top of what I call an altar, which I find a very interesting motif, but I'm not going to dwell on that now, and we'll keep moving along.
Here we have the testicles, and there's the phallus, and up in the back we have the female principle.
Just before we pop up the back to see the female principle, the female aspect, the accompanying vagina, if you will, that we expect to see around obelisks. We will notice that the obelisk itself here does sit amidst the female waters, reminding us, perhaps, of the Bomber Command War Memorial that we saw earlier on. If we look at an old illustration, an old concept of how this memorial might have been presented, we can see the two walls at the bottom there that are perhaps the testicles, reminding us of the Korean War Memorial that we saw earlier on as well. Now, we have the circular laurel wreath, perhaps reminding us of Rome, and the obelisk itself, reminding us of Egypt. So we are getting these themes of Rome and Egypt coming through in the symbolism as we go along, if you are looking for it. So let's head up the back here.
So here we are, and this is the Netherlands Australia Memorial, and we have the waters on the ground here coming out once again in this wedge-like fashion from the center here, from the watery center, just as we've seen in the Hellenic War Memorial there. But the female, the waters, the female element in there, and there's quite a bit there. And we also have here the two steps coming out, the labia minora and the labia majora of the vagina, the labia minora and the labia majora of the vagina. Once again.
So just before we depart from Russell, I'd just like to point a few things out. We had the wreaths here. They've laid them on the testicle in this case. I'm not sure how many of the people who laid them there would actually realize that is a perhaps a symbolic testicle in this case. But I'm sure that this man here, Governor General Jeffrey, had some idea. Notice the eagle here as well. And I'm sure that Governor General Bryce also has a very good idea of this symbolism and a whole lot more. So if we just look over Russell here, I'll just go through a few things. Number one, this is the Australian Department of Defence. This is the Australian Department of Defence headquarters. And these two buildings here are perhaps symbolic of the Joaquin and Boaz pillars, I would say. We have the memorial here, the obelisk memorial here. We have the Netherlands memorial here. Remember how it's got that sort of ray coming out of it? Well, we see that motif again here. So over and over again we see that motif. And here it is here as well. Now, the eagle motif or the phoenix motif, you see that through various militaries throughout the world. It has perhaps being carried on from Rome and perhaps even prior to Rome through the, you know, what you could say is perhaps the First Reich and the Third Reich and all the rest of it. The Americans use it. Australia uses it in the Royal Australian Air Force. Anyway, I'm wondering if you can see that, see an eagle within the road plan here. So I've drawn a line in, and I just think there is the possibility here that the eagle motif is part of the layout here in Russell, where our defence headquarters are here in Australia. Here's another possible way to get an eagle out of the area there. But it's just a possibility at best. Let's move on. So here we are looking down on the foreshore of Parliament House. We have Lake Burley Griffin here. Over here we have some trees planted in the constellation of the Southern Cross, and we have a star map here that is a gift from the Canadian government to Australia. Here is a closer picture of the star map. And here is the plaque. I'll just read off the plaque here a little. So we have a quote. "We humans are like semicircles. When we join, we form a circular place." That's by John McEwan. And further down here, "The design depicts the night skies of September in the northern and southern hemispheres." And further down we can read, the Southern Cross and North Star are featured in the work. Here is another picture, and you can see the black square here and black square here. I would suggest there's a white square here and a white square here, suggestive of a checkers. Another shot, you can see the Milky Way, the galactic plane running through here. And yet another shot, you can see the lines of declination going through here. Here I've highlighted the 8x8 square or squares in the middle here, a checkered board, if you will, a grid for the star map. And this is perhaps similar to the Masonic Lodge, and it's part of the symbology of the checkered floor, perhaps. So there are constellations on here, and I'm just pointing some of those out here. This is the ecliptic path through here. I've drawn that in. That is roughly where it is. And this is the south side here. And again, I've roughly drawn in the ecliptic path here. So basically we have a chunk out of the skies from the southern side, and another chunk out of the skies from the northern side. So here we have yet another star map, and this is in Melbourne. This is the Yarra River here, and this is on the south bank in Melbourne. So here is the plaque, and on the plaque we can read we have the number 11 here, 11 a.m. That's the time when the Prime Minister gave a speech. And it's aligned with the star map here. So basically what I'll just talk about for a moment here is the notion that perhaps world leaders do things according to when stars and planets are in a particular place, and do things at certain times as well. Hence we get these star maps. An example of this was the time when the armistice was signed at 11 a.m. French time, and it was signed in France at 11 a.m. on the 11th of November. That would be the 11th month in 1918. So you have three 11s there. So things are perhaps timed, and there are other instances of this, but I won't go into that now. So we'll just keep going, moving ahead here. Before we move on, I'd just like to point something else out that we have. We'll just read from here. Wattle blossoms represent the 1,000 most visible stars and planets. So 1,000. In other words, 1,000 lights we have on here. So there are sort of 1,000 lights, if you will. So this is looking down on the star map here beside the Yarra River in Melbourne. So 1,000 lights. Now this picture is from 2011, where pretty much on the winter solstice they had a festival, this festival here, and during this part of the festival here on the solstice they had the raising of 1,000 lights on the night of 1,000 lights. And you can hear George Bush talk about 1,000 points of light as well. So another part of this, a part of this festival here, by the way, is that the part of the motivation for organizing this festival, which pretty much runs over the solstice each year now in Melbourne, is that in Rome they had a festival, a Saturnalia festival, and that was also a festival of lights according to a Latin writer, Macrobius. So we're getting this, this is perhaps this festival is done in concert with that festival from Rome, that Saturnalia festival. Mm-hmm. Now, on a slight tangent here, there are aspects of etymology not readily supplied to the so educated masses. I see things that at least make me think. I venture forth without a reference manual in hand. I see a little of the craft and craftiness about me, and I realise that others don't think as I might expect them to. From the realms, some seemingly purposely flaunt their wares, although it is within a language not recognised by the masses, for it is not taught in school. Stanley Kubrick reversed the invisible game. He spoke of bears, moons, masks, and more. In the following speech, George H.W. Bush speaks to other occultists, whilst the public is unaware.
For not only leadership is passed from generation to generation, but so is stewardship. I've spoken of 1,000 points of light, of all the community organizations that are spread like stars throughout the nation doing good. We will work on this in the White House, in the cabinet agencies. I will go to the people and the programs that are the brighter points of light, and I'll ask every member of my government to become involved. The old ideas are new again because they're not old. They are timeless. Duty, sacrifice, commitment. And a patriotism that finds its expression in taking part and pitching in. Some higher purpose than ourselves. A shining purpose. The illumination of 1,000 points of light. I will keep America moving forward, always forward, for an endless, enduring dream and 1,000 points of light. This is my mission, and I will complete it.
1,000 lanterns here at Fitz Square. Let me see you. Let's celebrate together as a family. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Round of applause!
1,000 points of light.
The Points of Light Institute was founded on the back of George H.W. Bush's speeches regarding 1,000 points of light. The Institute had a Turning Point conference in 2012 on the solstice date, at the time of the solstice, just as we have the Night of 1,000 Lights in Melbourne at the time of the solstice. Here we have a tribute event that they had for the Institute, and we have it on the equinox date, and it was in 2011. Here we have Sears Tower. Now, this tower, from my point of view, has a nefarious look to it. I suspect that it is influenced from negative entities, what I would call negative entities, and perhaps they are from another dimension. This is the Château d'Amoureux in Belgium. There have been some writers who have written about it, Fritz Springmeier, Cisco Wheeler, and perhaps David Icke. Now, there's the possibility that there is a dome with 1,000 stars in it, in this chateau, and there is also the possibility that satanic rituals have been carried out there. Now, in 1945, Robert Oppenheimer later recalled that while witnessing the explosion, he thought of a verse from the Hindu holy book, the Bhagavad Gita. Now, so this is it. If the radiance of 1,000 suns were to burst at once into the sky, that would be like the splendor of the Mighty One. And then he later went on to say that another verse entered his head, and that was, I am become death, the destroyer of worlds. So, just looking at this, there is perhaps, a dark aspect to this 1,000 points of light, dare I say. Let's have a look at some bits and pieces around Canberra that I think are interesting. This is perhaps solar symbolism here, among other symbolism. We have Woden Cemetery, Edison Park here, an interesting building configuration here. We have interesting geometry here portrayed. And in this building also, this is perhaps a square or a compass. We have perhaps a solar window in the middle here with the wedges coming into that. Interesting configuration here on this building. The geoscience building. I do wonder what the designers of this building, of this complex, know about geoscience. Perhaps they know more than the average scientist, perhaps, through the mystery schools. Here we have the National Capital Exhibition Centre here. We'll have a closer look at that geometry there. We have the Captain Cook Memorial here, and we have a flagpole situated in a hexagram there. The flagpole is from Canada. The wedges here. So there is that geometry of the National Capital Exhibition Centre, and we see it again here in Darling Harbour, where there is a lot of sacred geometry. We also see it here on this phallus at the Bomber Command Memorial. So sacred geometry on the phallus, perhaps part of that, part of the meaning there. All right. We have water emanating out of the center here of the Captain Cook Memorial, and we see these strands coming out here, supportive strands, which are perhaps these rays as well, emanating from the center of the planet. That water is perhaps life force there. We have the Canadian flagpole here. It sits 36 meters above the ground. 36 is perhaps a number esoterically that is tied to the sun. The Australian Federal Police headquarters, we have the Kabbalah here. This centerpiece of the Kabbalah is perhaps reflected in here. We see the similar motifs here also, all through it. Here we have the wedge design. This is the Australian Institute of Criminology, and we have the Break Free Capital Tower here. This street is called Marcus Clark Street. Marcus Clark was a Freemason. There is a Marcus Clark building in Sydney. We have the Triple Tau here. The Triple Tau, solar symbolism perhaps in the centre here, and the cross and the rays coming out with the circle there. We see these motifs over and over and over again. Here's the Hyatt Hotel in Melbourne. We have the eagles here perched outside the Hyatt Hotel. There's also another eagle here perched in Melbourne in this park here. Now, this motif perhaps reminds us of Rome. Here we have the owl in Belconnen. So this is in Canberra. All these bird statues that we're seeing here are by the same artist, by the way. And here we have the Horizon apartments in Sydney. Some people can see the owl in that, some people can't. Here is Biology Place, and we have the DNA here in this building at the Canberra National University. Here we have the H.C. Coombs building. Here we have Fellows Oval. I just thought I'd point that out. You could perhaps read into that. And we have a figure eight here in the John 23 building that is affiliated with the Canberra National University. Here we have the magician with the infinity sign, or the figure eight, over his head there. Now, here we have a witch, perhaps, with a wand here, and this is from the Harry Potter movie, if you will. And here we have an ice cream, and we have this figure eight here. Now, that figure eight is perhaps reflective of the movement of a wand. Notice the name of the ice cream, Magnum. Magnum, magnetic. We perhaps live in an electromagnetic universe. And here we have what is perhaps some sort of vortex there, and we have a planet here as well. Now, the ice cream, what about this magic wand here and the ice cream? Could the stick of the ice cream the wooden stick of the ice cream be the wand, with the crystallization on the outside there, and ice crystals or ice or snowflakes make hexagrams. Here we have down here it's our biggest launch since Seven Deadly Sins, and we have these ice creams here, seven of them. 777. So here we have the Archbishop's residence in Canberra with solar symbolism there amidst the cross. And the Embassy of the United States of America. I think this is part of the embassy here. And we have this familiar symbolism here. It's all through Canberra, and the Maltese cross here. Maltese cross over and over. So we're now going to go to this part of Canberra here, Curtin. And we'll look at a few buildings here of interest, and we'll quickly look through those. This building houses the Teddy Bears Child Care Centre and the Emergency Services Headquarters. This is perhaps a pyramid in the centre here. The configuration will probably instantly remind one of the swastika. It's not necessarily nefarious. This is ancient symbolism and is perhaps tied to solar symbolism, among other things. So here it is. Building here. Here's another view. Beside it we have the Queen Elizabeth II Family Centre and the Peter Pan, the god Pan, early learning centre there in Curtin. We're now going to have a look down here. We have the Holy Trinity Primary School, some sacred geometry here perhaps too, in the Brindabella Gardens Nursing Home. So the Holy Trinity Primary School, and interesting configuration here, and again, interesting configuration, I think worth having a look at. Okay, Mount Stromlo Observatory. There is a sundial here, I would say, and it has the analemma in there. I think that would be it there. We see the wedge design here, and so forth and so forth. The Prime Minister's Lodge. I don't really have anything to say about symbolism here, but lodge, just the name in itself. We have the this Cook neighbourhood oval here. Now, many of them are like this, and they just happen to have a watering system that reflects sacred geometry, perhaps also. So you get that in the fields. Interesting. This is the scribe in a dam containing Lake Burley Griffin. I just thought I'd pop this in. Okay, so the Australian Federal Police National Headquarters possibly encrypts the Tree of Life, the Kabbalah, within the design there. Right now, we'll just have a look at this complex here, this building complex here, which lines up with the centre of Parliament here. So it's right beside the State Circle here. It's the R.G. Casey Building. Now, Richard Gardner Casey was a Freemason. So we'll just go in and have a closer look at this building. It houses DFAT, the Department of Foreign Affairs and Trade, here in Australia. Here's a closer look at it. You can see the checkers here. And yet another closer look. Here we can see what is perhaps a compass. I've highlighted these dots here. There are five of them. There's also one there, and there's possibly one within the building as well. That would make seven for the seven classical visible orbs in the sky. We're out the front of the building now, and there is a pillar here and a pillar there. I would suggest these are the pillars of Joachim and Boaz, the Masonic pillars. I've got no doubt about that, and so that's them there. Now, what I would also suggest is that they are possibly part of the Kabbalistic Tree of Life sort of layout within this building. So I've just put some highlights on there, some dots on there, and the middle pillar possibly runs along the ground through here. So here's a shot from above showing that middle pillar, and yet another shot for comparison here. Here is another shot. These pyramids on the roof here possibly also relate to these sephira on the pillar here. here is a comparison with the Egyptian pyramids there and the rooftop there. Now we're going to go to Anzac Square in Brisbane. And we're just going to have a look at on here. And once again, I've highlighted the sephora here that run up the middle of Anzac Square. And we'll have a look at a few more shots of this. Here are the outer pillars of severity and mercy. And I've just sort of highlighted in the sephora here. Okay, because some of these will, two of them will actually be right on the road as far as positioning goes. There is another shot looking down Anzac Square. We have a war memorial here. See the checkers once again. And I've highlighted it out there. So it goes something like that through Anzac Square. I've put it upside down here so that we can compare it with this diagram of the Kabbalistic Tree of Life. And here's another view above the square. Okay, this is a view looking down into Delhi, and it compares somewhat with the Tree of Life for sure. And once again, this particular street plan design here was based on the work of Walter Burley Griffin, who designed Canberra. Here is Washington DC, and we see this old Kabbalistic Tree of Life here in the Jesuit Kirch's drawing there, and it's compared with Washington DC there. And this was John Evelyn's old design for London. It didn't make it in, and the Kabbalah is possibly encrypted into that also. Now we're in the beautiful Queen Victoria building in Sydney, so let's have a look in here.
This is the Queen Victoria building, and if we look below onto the beautiful tiled floor, we see the Kabbalah.
So as you can see, we have the Kabbalistic Tree of Life incorporated into the floor here. We have the checkers here, we have the Star of David here as well. We perhaps have symbolism of the elements here. There is a lot of symbolism in this building. Now over here we have the Kabbalistic Tree of Life, and we have the pillars of Boaz and Jachin here. One negative, one positive, female, male, magnetism, electricity, so forth and so forth, and then they perhaps join in the middle here. So we would have, say, female, male, and then joining in the middle here, joining in the middle. So what do we see here if this is the middle? Do we see the testicles and the penis going into the vagina? I would suggest that is the case. Now this is symbolism for people who are initiated into the occult realms, if you will. So here we have it here, and as you can see, it's positioned right in the middle here. And I would suspect that that is no mistake. This may remind us of the church, with the unity in the middle of that building as well, of the male and the female. The male penis here, with the vaginal wall around it. Penis, vagina. Okay?